Now let's talk a little bit about HPC, high performance computing, and then we'll finish out with edge computing. For HPC, we most often have an aggregate of computer nodes, and they're seen as a single system. They're designed to solve complex calculations or manipulate data at a very high speed. For HPC, these systems are designed specifically for what we're doing. And here, just like with anything in IT, it's super critical we have the right amount of these three components. Compute, that's the CPU, that's the brains of the organization, network, and storage. If we have a bottleneck on any of those, it's going to be a lot less efficient than we need it to be, because if we don't have enough network, well, that's a bottleneck. It doesn't really matter then that we have all the compute and storage that we need, because we can't transmit the data fast enough. The same with storage or compute. All three needs to be designed and aligned with what we need for resources whenever the HPC performs its tasks. The most well-known types of HPCs are supercomputers. Not all HPCs are supercomputers, but all supercomputers are HPCs. It's a subset. And then finally, let's look at edge computing. And with edge computing, it really is us moving the data as close as possible to whomever needs it. We move the data as close to the end user or the system that needs that data. And it's not just the data, it's obviously also the compute. And it makes sense, right? We want it all to be faster. We just talked about CDNs. They are the most common type of edge computing. But again here, not all edge computing are CDNs. Just like all distributed systems are also not CDNs, but all CDNs are distributed systems. So let's say we work for a large organization and we have 500 offices spread across the globe. Now, if I'm in Puerto Rico and I need to go to Denmark because that's where the headquarters is to pull some data, it's going to give me a pretty high latency. So me getting that data is going to take longer than it should. It's much more efficient to bring that data closer to me. On top of that, it's also going to use more bandwidth in both places. So we take the resources that make sense and move them as close as possible to where they're needed. That will drastically reduce both my latency and the bandwidth that I use, because it's not just sending, it's also receiving. And this doesn't have to be everything. Let's say our company has an e-commerce website. Well, then we want the backend where all the actual orders happen. We want that in our data center. But the front end page, the login page, where they go to search for products, all that might be pushed out to our CDN, to our edge computing. And then when they pick something they want to buy and they go to pay for it, then and only then do they get sent to our main data center. All the other stuff happens on the CDN. And there are a ton of good use cases for edge computing. That can be security systems, image recognition systems, IoT, Internet of Things, self-driving cars, and CDNs, which we already covered. It can be medical devices, video conferencing. I remember when I worked at that hospital in Hawaii, we had a huge project where we chose, because of latency, to have the systems of our patient records stored locally in our two data centers, and not in the data center that the vendor wanted in California. Now, on a normal transaction, when everything is working well, we would have maybe 20, 30 milliseconds to send it from Hawaii to California and in reverse. But what if? And because of that what if, using our risk analysis, we chose to have the applications in our data centers, not just because of the latency, but also because this was a truly critical system. If anything happened to the internet connection between Hawaii and California, our hospital staff could not access patient records. So here, just like with everything else, we do the proper risk analysis and we move the things that make sense to CDNs or edge computing. All right, let's recap virtualization, cloud, and distributed computing. We started out by talking about virtualization. That's where we have many servers, those are the clients, on the same hardware platform, that is the host. And there are a ton of benefits to virtualization. It's much cheaper, it's much easier to use, we use less cooling, we use less power, it has a much smaller footprint in our data center, and it's much easier to stand up new servers. It really just is, create new server, choose the resources, choose the operating system, maybe load an image that we have already done, and within less than an hour, you have a new server. We can also allocate resources either dynamically or manually if a certain server needs more resources for a short amount of time. We talked about the different types of hypervisors, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 is what we would have in our data center. This is hardware that's built specifically for virtualization. It has the hardware, and then it has the hypervisor, and on top of that, we build all the virtual machines. This is also what all the cloud providers use. A type 2 hypervisor is what you and I would have on our own systems. I have my PC, I have my operating system on that, and then as an application on that operating system, I have a hypervisor. Using that hypervisor, I can then build virtual machines on my system. And then, of course, using virtualization comes with a whole new set of security concerns, things we need to think about before we deploy. We want a similar protection profile for all the systems on one host. So in the case there's VM escape, where an attacker can jump from one client to another, it's within the same trust level. Just like we did with single sign-on, there needs to be added security, because with single sign-on, now you just don't have access to one system, you have access to 20. The same thing here. If you gain access to the hypervisor, instead of having access to one server, you might have access to 500. And then, of course, we need to keep a very close eye on the resources. It's very common for admins to oversubscribe them, or for the data owner to actually have access to allocate resources to their own servers. It's just a bad idea. Then we moved into cloud computing. We talked about how there is no cloud. It's just someone else's computer somewhere else, just like there's no internet. It's just a bunch of connections between ISPs, WAN providers, and long-haul providers. And when we use cloud computing, we either build or outsource some parts of our IT infrastructure, storage, and applications. We talked about private and public cloud. Private, we own and run it on our own infrastructure. Public, this is shared tenancy. And this is what 99% of all cloud computing is. This is AWS, Google, IBM. They build massive infrastructures, and we rent a small part of that. Then we had hybrid cloud computing. That's a mix between private and public. The stuff that makes sense, we host in our own data center. Normally, things where latency or higher security is important. And then everything else, where it makes sense, we put on public cloud. And then finally, we had community cloud. And that really is used for a special community or customers from an organization that have a shared concern. That was the one where all the hospital systems and anyone in healthcare in Hawaii, they had a community cloud they can use for the projects they're working on together. Then the big part, the different types of public cloud. We talked about infrastructure as a service. The name kind of indicates what it is. The vendor is responsible for everything, including the virtualization. We put the operating system, the databases, the security, the applications on top of that. Then we have platform as a service. Here, we are only responsible for the applications and the data. And then finally, software as a service. Here, we are only responsible for the data. In many cases, these are vendor-specific applications. That was the one where I had the example with when we discharge patients from that hospital. We integrate our patient data with their application, and their application then does all the behind-the-scenes work. Then we talked about distributed systems, which often also is called distributed computing environments. That's where we move the system out as close as possible to the end user, regardless if it is a person or a system. And we do that because it gives a better user experience, the latency is lower, it also gives us horizontal scaling, meaning if I have 7 and I want to expand to 20, I just add 13 systems more that are geographically dispersed depending on what I'm trying to achieve. It has a higher fault tolerance because if one of my 7 systems go down, I still have the other 6. It's cost effective and it gives us that low latency that people expect online. And we really use it everywhere. It's the internet, it's websites, it's cell phone networks, it's research, it's peer-to-peer networks, it's blockchain, and thousands of other things. Then we talked about high-performance systems. The most well-known type here are supercomputers. We have built all these systems with the specs we need exactly for this one task. And then we have a user or a scheduler that controls all those systems. The important part here, just like with anything else we do with servers, is we need to have enough compute, network, and storage for whatever we're doing. They need to be aligned. And then finally, we talked about edge computing. Here, we bring the data as close as possible to wherever that data is needed, and we do that by moving the data and the compute resources. And this again here lowers the bandwidth use and it lowers the latency. With edge computing, the most commonly used type are CDNs. All CDNs are edge computing and distributed computing, but not all distributed or edge computing is CDNs. And I think close to 80% of large enterprises have already implemented or are in the process of implementing edge computing in their organizations. And with that, we are done with these topics. I hope this has helped you get a little bit of a better understanding of virtualization, cloud, and distributed systems. I think it is important to also spend a little more time here because this is such critical knowledge. So rewatch the videos, go read up on them online until this is something you're very clear on. Thank you for being here, and I will see you in the next lecture.